Good morning, everyone. Welcome to our Sunday knowledge sharing webinar for parents. Thank you so much for joining us on this beautiful Sunday morning. We at Rainbow Children's Hospital are doing our bit for the community in this testing times of the COVID pandemic. Throughout the lockdown, we have been open. Our doctors are present here throughout the day, and we've been serving the community at large. In the last 6 months itself, we have seen more than 20,000 patients, children and women, on the OPD basis, and we have treated more than 2,300 patients on the IP basis. So during the conversations with the parents of and our doctors, we heard that there were a lot of questions that parents had. They always had a doubt on how to reach out to the doctors, should they have to rush to the hospital for common ailments, what can they do to manage at home for their children's well-being. So that's the reason why we came up with this idea of having webinars for parents, where we share with them, with our experts, we can actually share and have all the doubts of the parents resolved. So thank you again for joining us, and let's begin today's webinar. I have with me today Dr. Aditi and Dr. Madhusudan. A little bit of what our experts. Dr. Aditi is our pediatric gastroenterologist and hepatologist. She has done her MBBS and MD in pediatrics from LHMC New Delhi. She has over 5 years of experience in pediatric gastroenterology, and she has extensive experience in managing childhood constipation, reflux disorders, diarrhea. She's also well trained in performing diagnostic and therapeutic endoscopies in children and percutaneous liver biopsies in pediatric liver diseases. And of course, we have Dr. Madhusudan. Dr. Madhusudan is our consultant pediatrician and pediatric intensivist. He is someone who has completed his post-graduation and senior residency from PGI Jaipur, Chandigarh. It's a premier pediatric institution in the country. Over 9 years of experience have made him take care of the sickest children with complex diseases. He is well versed in treatment protocols and procedural skills required to manage any complex childhood illness, including post-transplant patients, renal replacement therapy, and ECMOs. Their areas of interest are pediatric emergencies, infectious diseases, and critical care ultrasound. So welcome, doctors, and welcome to all the parents. I start off this webinar by first asking a question to Dr. Madhusudan. Sir, what are the common infections in children?
Hi, good morning, all of you. It's a pleasure to be here with all of you and trying to answer your queries. So we hope to create more awareness among all of you in this tough time. So children face a lot of problems. Like, most of them are quite mild. And many of them, as you may have understood, is just part of growing up. And children itself, the term includes right from newborn babies to adolescents up to 12 or 14 years of age. We are dealing with a wide age range. The commonest infections that, even as you are also aware, are usually respiratory or gastrointestinal. So respiratory infections are the common colds, sore throats, or sometimes severe infections like pneumonias or ear infections. And the commonest gastrointestinal infections can be gastritis or gastroenteritis. So these are some of the common infections. The other infections include urinary tract infections and ear infections, as I already mentioned, and skin and soft tissue infections, which can be as mild as boils or furuncles that we commonly see. And some of the more serious infections, which are much less common, are infections of the brain, which is called meningitis, or the infections, generalized infections in the blood, which are called sepsis. So these are some of the common infections that we see. So usually respiratory or gastrointestinal.
Okay. Thank you, doctor. May I move on to the next question with Dr. Aditi?
Thank you, Dr. Girija. And greetings.
So my question to you, ma'am, is that when you think your baby has an upset stomach or loose motions, and how can we manage at home?
So staying at home has become a necessity these days, and I'm sure symptoms like diarrhea, loose motion, vomiting, these may still be occurring. And the problem is you cannot rush to hospital with every little symptom. So when do you decide their child is having a loose motion or an upset tummy? Is depends on the age. So if your baby is a newborn or a first 2 months old baby, they may have stools up to 4 or 5 times a day, but the stools will be yellow, toothpaste like, little seedy. You needn't worry about them. And as long as the child is gaining weight and is happy looking, you needn't worry. When the child becomes around 2 years, he follows a normal adult pattern. So he will be going once in a day, soft yellow stools. So you call it a diarrhea when either the consistency changes. So you think that the stools have become more loose, more watery, it is flowing out of a diaper, or you think it is more frequent. So more frequent than what normally child does. So if your child usually does 2 to 3 times, it's not diarrhea. But from 2 to 3 times, suddenly he has started doing 6 times, 7 times, and he is looking little pale. He's complaining of little pain abdomen. He's also having a little bit of vomiting with that. You should consider this to be a diarrhea. And how to manage at home, it is very important that you should keep your child hydrated. That is the first thing which we all advise our parents. Hydrated means he should take enough liquids, be it water, be it ORS, be it your dal soup, your broth, anything which you which is easily available at home. And when should you decide that, you know, this it is not helping and my child is becoming more lethargic, he's complaining of excessive pain which you can't just manage with a syrup or a paracetamol, or you feel the blood in there are blood in stools, these are the times when you may have to take a video consult or even have to come to hospital to take a professional consultation.
Okay,
that should be Dr. Girija.
Yes, Dr. Aditya. So Dr. Madhu, I think fever is something which is very common in children. And what do you think parents should know about fever in children?
Yeah, so fever is probably the commonest reason why children are brought to clinics or hospitals. So fever, as you know, in simple terms, is just elevated body temperature. So as such, like, it is important for us to know, even in a normal day when we are all healthy, our body temperature keeps fluctuating. So the normal fluctuation is said to be somewhere between 96 even up to 100 degrees Fahrenheit. So the maximum temperatures in a normal person are seen somewhere in the late afternoon or evening, and the minimum temperature somewhere in the early morning. Even as such, there are fluctuations. The first question to be answered here is there fever? Is there really fever? So the definition of fever, like according to doctors, is a rectal temperature more than 100. So here we are referring to the core body temperature inside the body. But what we usually check with thermometers at homes or even in hospitals is either the oral temperature by keeping the thermometer in the mouth, or the axillary temperature, which may be around 1 degree Fahrenheit, actually lesser than the core body temperature. So if the child is having temperatures of more than 99 to 100 as a recent symptom, so that qualifies for fever. So here again, it is important for all parents, especially at this time, to have a thermometer at home, know how to measure, check the temperature. In an older child, it can be by placing the thermometer under the tongue, or in a younger child, it can be by keeping the thermometer in the axilla, that is the armpit, for at least 2 to 3 minutes till the thermometer beeps. So if you are getting a temperature of more than 100, that qualifies for fever. So many times we see that parents are actually not able to record temperatures and they just feel the child by the back of their hand. That is not a very accurate method, especially to know when there is fever or not. So it is better to have a thermometer at home. And coming to the causes of fever, usually it is because of infection. Sometimes, especially newborn babies and all that, because of dehydration or because of fluid losses, also there can be elevated body temperature, but the commonest cause is infection, and infection can be anywhere. So fever itself is not the disease, fever is just a symptom of a disease, and the disease can be any minor disease. Usually it is a minor one, it can be a common cold or diarrhea. They can all start with fever, need not have any other symptoms at that time for the first 1 or 2 days, and after the next 1 or 2 days, we may be able to say where the infection is. And another common question which parents ask is, they get very worried when the temperature crosses 102 or 103. As such, the number itself does not point to whether the condition has become serious or not. So just by the number, don't get scared. As long as the child looks active, is able to feed, is passing urine, and is not drowsy or lethargic, even if the temperature is 102 or 103, nothing immediately to like worry or rush to the hospital. But even if the temperature is 100 or 101, but you find that your child is looking very tired, lethargic, not able to take orally, then that is something to be worried. So don't just get scared looking at the numbers. And the numbers itself don't tell us whether to do blood tests or start injection. So they just the number itself does not decide anything much.
Okay. Dr. Aditi, I have a parent who's asked a question here. When there's a fever, the child is very fussy to it and hardly takes anything. So what do you think should be done in this situation?
So this is a very valid question. See, when the child starts running fever, he loses interest in the environment. So he will become more inactive, prefers staying at one place, loses his interest in play, as well as loses interest in eating. So the first thing which we should do, as Dr. Madhu has already said, we should record the temperature. If it is more than 100, we should just give him Crocin or paracetamol. And the doses, if the parents are not clear, they can take a video consult with the doctor what the dose is for their child. And the fever should come down in an hour or so. Sometimes if the fever is high grade, persistent, continuous, not improving despite paracetamol, you may have to visit the hospital. Initial 1 to 2 hours, child may not take enough food. They should keep himself hydrated, give him sips of water, give him his favorite food, small bits of pieces. As soon as the fever comes down, you will notice the child again comes back to his normal, starts eating. So force feeding while the child is having fever may not help. You can just keep him hydrated enough. If he still doesn't eat after the fever has settled, it is a red flag sign, and in that case, the parent should visit a hospital. Dr. Madhu, you want to add something to it?
Yeah, like, can I just add about what we do to control fever here? So usually, yeah, like, you must all be...
Yeah, definitely. Please go on.
Yeah. So the commonest medication you must all be aware of is paracetamol. So it is called by different names according to the brands as Calpol, Crocin, P250, etc. So that is the commonest drug, and that is the safest drug. So what we all recommend as doctors is, so when a child is having a documented fever, you have checked the temperature and the temperature is more than 100. So the simplest medicine that you should all be having at home is paracetamol. For the exact dosage, it is better to contact your doctor first, or if you have already been advised, it is usually 10 to 15 mg per kg. If you've already been advised how much to give, you can repeat it 4 to 6 hours later again if the fever is not subsiding. So the recommended dosage at least 4 to 6 hours apart is what we use. Here it is, rather than switching to different drugs, it is better to use one drug properly and monitor the temperature properly. So this is the best and the most effective way to control fever. Other than this, fever as such, when the body temperature increases, there is increased requirement for fluids and there is a risk of dehydration. So all children with fever should be given plenty of fluids. So that itself can make a lot of difference. So plenty of fluids, paracetamol in the prescribed dosage every 4 to 6 hours repeated if the fever is persisting. And the other common thing that we all do, but not very much evidence-based, but still not harmful, so can be done, is tepid sponging. So here it's important to make your child wear something light. So the clothes should be light. You can use the fan or the AC if the child is comfortable with it. Give plenty of fluids and do tepid sponging. Tepid sponging does not mean that you put a wet cloth and leave it there. It just means that you expose more of the body surface to the atmosphere and wipe as much as possible the whole body with the lukewarm water or a wet cloth repeatedly. So that is the way to do tepid sponging rather than just placing a cloth and leaving it there. But as such, there is not much evidence since it's not harmful. It can be done if the temperature is not coming under control.
Great. So that answers how can fever be managed at home. Now, we were talking about video consults, right? So like how Dr. Madhu and Dr. Aditi both spoke about it, instead of just rushing the child to the hospital, if you're worried, we can always do a video consult. And this is a safe way to consult with a doctor. You can either log on to our website at www.rainbowhospitals.in or call us at 1-800-2122 and we'll definitely be able to help you out with the video consultation. Coming on to a common problem which is there for children, that's poor eating and feeling pukish. Dr. Aditi, you want to add on this?
Thank you, Dr. Girija. So as I told you, the routine has actually got very upset because of this whole staying indoors. Most of the children have a very altered routine, not going to school, sleeping late, getting up late morning, missing breakfast, and having a brunch instead, and a lot of junk foods in their diet. So a lot of time you will face a lot of gastric issues are coming up, especially when the child, they don't have time to play, they're not going outdoors, they don't have any other recreation except for screen, which is either a laptop or a phone or a TV. So we are getting children who have issues like this. They wake up in morning and they either feel very nauseated. Nauseated means they feel pukish, and if you try to feed them, they actually vomit. And if you try to feed them normal food the whole day, they keep tripping and they are very finicky eaters. So these problems are coming up, and the most common cause is because the whole routine has got upset. They have a problem called reflux. Reflux, or something called in simple word, is acidity. And don't be surprised if I tell that even in children, acidity problem is there, and it is not just a problem of adults or elderly. So if they don't eat properly, they have a gap of more than 12 hours, like they had last dinner at 9 o'clock and they wake up 10 o'clock in morning. So such children are prone to acidity. And when they get up, they will feel pukish. And especially if empty stomach, we are giving them milk or liquids or juices, the tendency further worsens. So such children need to be managed very skillfully, but at home in a safe environment. They just need to be monitored. They need to be given frequent small meals that too home-based. So if you are a rice eater or a wheat eater or ragi eater, it doesn't matter. You should just give him a cereal-based diet. So more of cereals, less of dairies, more of fruits and vegetables in the diet. You will notice that those children are feeling less, they will feel less of acidity. Empty stomach milk, I won't recommend. I would say every morning children get up, they should get a proper breakfast. Breakfast includes, again, as I told you, you should follow a triangular pyramid. So the base is formed by the cereals. So the maximum amount of diet should be cereals. Then comes the fruits and vegetables. And the apex of the pyramid is formed by dairy, by meat, mutton, or poultry. And very least is the ghee or the butter. So if you follow a proper food diet, I think a lot of these problems can be skipped. But just in case your child doesn't improve with these issues, you have video consult, and we have medicines for reflux, for refractory cases. And sometimes it doesn't improve, then I would advise you to come to a hospital and visit us if the vomiting just doesn't improve with simple medications and video consult. And as usual, we always have to track the weight. So if the baby is not gaining weight for next 2 to 3 months, 6 months, this is something alarming, and we should visit the hospital.
Dr. Madhu, for you, what should parents know about common cold?
Yeah. So again, as I told you, this is the commonest infection probably in children that we see every day. And what parents should know is a common cold is something very common, and it is the most common cause for colds are infections, and most of the times they are viral. So this is something which is a very mild illness. And as you must have experienced with your children, like initially they start getting a running nose or a blocked nose. Some of them may be having a noisy breathing, they may be having mild fever, sometimes even high grade fever. Some of them may vomit, they become very tired, they may not accept everything orally. These are some of the common symptoms of common cold that we see. And as such, like upper respiratory tract infections, like as you know, can start in the nose, mouth, the throat. So even sore throats are part of the upper respiratory tract infections. So what you should know is most of the times they are viral. And yes, like now that we are in the COVID time, some of the things have got complicated, which we'll be talking soon about to you. But coming to the treatment of common cold, it is usually symptomatic treatment. So as parents, it is very important for you to know that if it is a viral infection, there is no road for antibiotics. Antibiotics take care of bacterial infections, but most of the colds are viral, where antibiotics have no role. So again, symptomatic treatment means look for fever, document the fever, and treat the fever well, as I had already explained to you. Give the child plenty of fluids. And if you feel that there is a lot of stuffiness, or the nose is blocked, or there's a nasal discharge, one thing that is recommended is a saline nasal drop. That is a plain saline nasal drop without any drug. So that can be used even in small babies. It is something very safe. and something very helpful. So other than increasing the water intake and using saline nasal drops, many of the other treatments may not be necessary. And one important thing that I would like to tell here is about the use of cough syrups. So there are plenty of cough syrups in the market, and they have different varieties of drugs. Some of the drugs are not very mild or benign drugs. They can cause serious side effects. So the recommendations say that less than 2 years of age, where infections are predominantly bacterial, there is no need for antibiotics, and cough syrups can be dangerous. So they're not recommended for children below 2 years of age. 2 to 6 years of age, yes, if your doctor sees and feels that a cough syrup may help, you may give it under the advice of a doctor. More than 6 years, probably it is slightly safer. It may not help much. So overall for cough syrups, there is no proof that it works or helps. It can be dangerous in very small children, and it has to be taken under the recommendation of a doctor. So it is not something as a routine. Though many times we see parents just going to the chemists and buying cough syrups and giving it. So you better be careful. It may not help, and in young children, it may be harmful. And antibiotics also, it is very important. So what happens is, suppose it is a viral infection, and you give antibiotics. And normally also in our throats or anywhere in our bodies, there are lots of organisms sitting there which are a part of a normal body. So many bacteria are the good bacteria, which are part of a normal body. So what happens is when they are exposed to unnecessary antibiotics, they gradually become resistant to it. And so many bacteria now which are resistant to so many antibiotics that we have is a burning issue today. So it is a responsibility to use antibiotics responsibly. Use it only when your doctor is telling you to use them. And many times I hear from my own colleagues that like parents are very impatient, kind of impatient when their kids are not improving. So it is important to know that any common cold takes at least 5 to 7 days to completely resolve. It is important to be patient. As long as a child is not sick and you have shown your doctor and he has reassured you, just continue the same treatment instead of kind of forcing doctors to give you antibiotics, which may actually harm the child more.
Okay.
So for a simple cough and cold, it's fine. There is no need to worry.
Fine. Dr. Madhu, I also have a parent here asking, of late noticing rashes on my 5-year-old cheeks. There is no itching, no fever, not a mosquito bite, but it's quite visible and the skin is rough. So should they visit us?
Yeah, so again, like if it is, it's better to see the rash once, like how it is, and that can be easily done through a video consultation. You need not visit the hospital. The commonest cause for rash also are viral infections. Sometimes they may not have fever, or the fever can be very mild. And the other important cause is any kind of allergy to something. Sometimes we may not know what the child is allergic to, but these are some of the common causes. And it is better that doctor sees the rash ones.
Okay, thank you, sir. And Dr. Aditi, I have a parent, Kaustubh Kaura, who's asking, my first son, who is now 5 years old, used to feel constipated when he was 1 year old. Now my second son is also constipated. He does not normally do potty for 7 to 8 days continuously. Is it fine?
So Dr. Girija, I think my next question was about this only, which I was taking. So it's a very valid question these days. This is definitely not fine if your child and baby is passing stools once in a week. Normal recommendation is please they should pass twice in a week, and it should be small, soft and smooth. So any infrequent hard stools or painful stools is not a good sign. They should either do a video consult or visit hospital if they can and show their child.
Okay, could you also talk to us something about the itching bum or continuous pain in the tummy?
Right, so thank you. So the this complaint that school going children, you will be noticing that your children at home mostly complain of pain in belly on and off. So these symptoms could be of constipation and nothing else in children. So they'll have a mild pain of 1 or 2 minutes, then they will start doing their activity, or as the parents that had at previous question was there, they would notice that the child is passing stools once in a week. So those things are nothing but constipation, and constipation has become rampant in this scenario because most of the children are indoors and have an altered routine. So definitely if your child is having hard stools, infrequent stools, blood in stools, large caliber stools, it is constipation and you need assessment. And at the same time, if you notice that your baby is itching at the bum at night, or you have evidently seen worms and you've not done a deworming over the last 6-7 months, it's time to deworm. Generally, we recommend parents to deworm mostly after 2 years of age. And though it is not a recommendation, but we preferably tell them that it should be done at least 6 monthly. So those things can be done online also. You don't need to come to hospital. Just you have to be observant. And sometimes itching in the bum is because of constipation as well. So you need to give a proper history. You need to notice how your child is passing stool. He's not withholding. So withholding is something like they will stand near the corner. They will just not sit in the potty. You will see they will squeeze their bum or do a tiptoe position when they are trying. This is nothing, but they're trying to hold on to the stool. So this is again constipation and they need to be assessed.
Okay, we have Mrs. Deepthi who is asking us, can the child have allergy to potato? They have observed that whenever they've given her potato, she's had severe vomiting. Dr. Aditi, could you please help answer this question?
So the sixth most common food allergens, which we know is milk, egg, soya, fish foods, snails, and chestnuts. So these are the six most common, but then there are different allergies and different spectrum and different varieties. So if the parents are the most observant, if they notice that the child is having specifically with one food, they should definitely take a consult, because though potato is not a very common allergen, because it is more of starch and less of protein. Only the protein part of the foods are known to be allergens, but I wouldn't say that it's not completely ruled out. You take an expert opinion, allergy specialist and gastroenterologist, and then we can sort it out. Especially because he has gastrointestinal symptoms. Vomiting post ingestion could be a part of eosinophilic esophagitis or some type. It is a type of an allergy. So definitely he needs one visit.
Okay, I've been getting a lot of questions on vaccinations as well. We'll soon come on to that. But Dr. Madhu, could you tell me when should parents be worried?
Yeah, so this is a kind of a general question. So as I told you, children itself is a like wide age range. So right from newborn babies to older children. Older children are more articulate. They're able to express their discomfort and anxiety is better. So parents also feel more confident. And yes, as doctors also, we feel much more confident with older children because the symptoms and the signs are much more clearer. As regard to young babies or young infants who may not be able to express, and the symptoms are very non-specific. Whatever the illness, the symptoms may be the same, that they may stop accepting feeds, they may look dull or are not as active as before. So especially when you're having babies or small infants, if they are accepting feeds well, and if their interaction with you is quite okay, that is like when they're making eye contact, they are playful in between when there is no fever, their breathing looks comfortable, they are able to sleep comfortably, they're passing urine and stools normally. So these are some of the good signs which tell us that probably there is no serious infection. So even if there is fever and some cold cough, it is probably a minor infection. But if your child or baby is not accepting feeds well, not passing urine, not even once in 6 hour duration, and looking very dull and lethargic, and even when there is no fever, he is not looking well, and the breathing is fast, or any of these symptoms are called danger signs. So this may suggest an emergency, and this is best tackled in a hospital. So if you notice any of these signs in the common illnesses, it is best to either call up your doctor immediately or take him to the closest doctor.
Okay, thank you. We have one parent here who's asked a very valid question, that there are a few days the child is sneezing in the morning, especially after waking up, but there is no cold and there is no running nose. Is this an infection, Dr. Madhu?
Yeah, if it is something very recent and occurring only for the past few days, and previously the child had been completely well, sneezing can just be part of an upper respiratory tract infection like a common cold. Sometimes it is because of allergy. Again, like many times, it may be difficult to say what the child is allergic to, especially if it is allergy, it occurs repeatedly. For example, in one particular season every year, some children, when they're exposed to dust, they develop these symptoms. sometimes to like when they have pets at home or to some specific odors, cold foods. These are some of the common allergens that we see. So if it is something recent, not much in the past, and no other symptoms, breathing is fine, no fever, then you need not worry. It can just be a part of a minor infection at this point of time.
Okay. So since we are having a lot of questions on vaccinations, Dr. Madhu, could you just elaborate as which kind of vaccinations are necessary at this time? Should we postpone? Should we come to the hospital and take the vaccination?
Yeah. So as you know, like vaccines are something which require repeated visits, especially in the first year of life. And during the lockdown, lots of parents must have faced a lot of problems with vaccinations, though our hospital was open all the time. The thing is, even during the lockdown, what we suggested to parents was, there are some vaccines which should not be delayed for more than a few days, maximum a week. And these vaccines are the ones which come at 1.5, 2.5, and 3.5 months of age, and the one at 9 months of age. So it is probably not a good idea to delay them for a long time. A few days is fine, probably up to a week. And it is good not to delay beyond that, because these are some of the mandatory vaccines which protect against some life-threatening diseases. Especially for very young babies, it is best to get them on time and not to delay them much. But for those vaccines which are coming after 1 year, and except the one at 1.5 years of age, the DPT boosters again, and the MMR at 15 months. So 15 and 18 months are again sort of mandatory vaccines. There are a lot of other vaccines which are kind of optional, which are called optional vaccines, but many parents get them nowadays. They are advised to all. So they can be delayed for up to 1 or 2 weeks. But as you all know, COVID is not something which is going to go away in a few weeks or months. It is probably there for some time now, and we are all changing our lifestyles to suit the pandemic. And nowadays, since we have video consultations or even home visits for vaccinations, where one member from our medical and nursing team will visit your house, administer the vaccine, and watch the child for about 30 minutes to see that there are no adverse effects. So it is something that is safe to do and recommended, rather than postponing the vaccine for a long time.
Great. So as you've also seen that I've displayed, we are doing this community and the home-based vaccinations where we come to your building or your apartment. We can vaccinate multiple families at a time. We are even offering the flu or the pneumococcal shots for the adults in the family if anybody is interested. And this is something that we can definitely make use of at this time presently. Dr. Aditi, Princy Saxena has a question for you. In order to build immunity in kids, do you think any daily supplements like vitamin C and others are helpful?
So immunity is all dependent on how healthy I am or how healthy my child is. So if the child is doing well, his weight is good, his height is good, he's appropriate for age, he has no underlying chronic issues like any asthma, any chronic diarrhea, IBD, I would not recommend a daily supplementation. Yeah, but these days, during this COVID pandemic, it is being suggested that if there is a viral symptom in a child or an adult, we can give 15-day supplement of vitamin C and a multivitamin. But in long run, how long it has to be continued, in that case, I would not recommend it to be taken completely for next 2 months, 3 months. And in fact, I would more elaborate on a proper diet, so in a home-based diet with the fresh fruits and seasonal vegetables. Those would add more benefit to a child's health, and rather than depending only on medicines and supplements. What is your take on that, Dr. Madhu?
Yeah, so like I think it's important for parents to understand that a good immunity does not depend on taking a medicine alone. So it is more to do with the diet. And another very underrecognized aspect here is good sleep. So good sleep also contributes to good immunity. So a wholesome diet, good sleep, good activity, all that boosts your child's immunity much more than a syrup can do. So it's more important to emphasize on these things.
Yeah, so the vitamin C which you're giving as a supplement, you can just follow citrus fruits, lemon, oranges, the easily available fruits. Those can help you, and the multivitamins you can get from any normal food which you eat, fresh fruits.
Okay. So there's one more question by Mrs. Rachna. She's asking, her child has not been given BCG vaccine because she was not born in India. is this okay, or should be she should take the vaccination now?
What is the age of the child now?
I think the age of the child is 4 years.
Yeah, I think catch up BCG vaccination till 5 years of age, it is probably better to take. So as you know, BCG is a vaccine which protects against the serious forms of tuberculosis. The vaccine itself has a very wide range of efficacy, but we give it to all Indian children at birth. So as per the recommendations, till 5 years of age, if anybody has not got it, can get it once.
Okay. Now in
this
all
is not the usual case, like usually all are sorry to interrupt you. I think like you can just get in touch with us later. We will just tell you what to do exactly, because this is not the usual scenario that we get, and especially during this COVID time, whether you need to come to the hospital or like, I think all these issues, if you can get in touch with us later, we'll just explain it to you.
Sure, I'm sure the parent will do that. Now, for both the doctors, Dr. Aditi, if you could go first, how does COVID-19 change the present healthcare scenario for the children? What do you think should parents be doing more at home?
So I would say we have seen a lot of changes in last 3 months, and the next 3-4 months will again will be a testing time. It will not change. And it is not just difficult for parents. I think it is even difficult for children. And to mostly what we understand is the stress of the parents, but we should also take the stress of the children. Sometimes they are not getting used to this new situation. They have to be told, explained why they are staying at home, why they are not going out as frequently as they used to, and why there has been changes in their lifestyle. So we should take care of children as well. Their thinking, they should be growing healthy. So even their thinking part should be growing healthy, because we have seen children coming with pain, abdomen, headache, and other things which are actually nothing but stress radiating as pain. So those things have to be seen. The other thing is regarding the lifestyle. So if they are not going outdoors, we should arrange something indoors. So yoga maybe, or aerobics, and more of indoor games like chess, carom, rather than sitting on the screen for more time. So those things will have to be decided by parents, what they think will be more beneficial for the baby without affecting their lifestyle, because next 3-4 months again will be a testing time for both, not just parents but even children. But because parents, most of them are staying indoors and working, they are also busy, they can't give enough time, but they should just decide how they can keep their babies or children busy without making it unsafe by taking them outside.
Great. Dr. Madhu, do you want to add on this, please?
Yeah, like as Aditi has said, it's important to ensure continuing development of all the children, like in spite of the pandemic. And here the like one thing that it complicates is the hospital visits that we used to do so easily earlier. And since common cold as such, like COVID-19 also presents when it affects us, it also presents like a common cold. So there is no way to differentiate whether it is because of some other virus or the cold is because of COVID-19. So as of today, what the guidelines say is also keep changing every day, but the current guidelines say that if any child or adult is having fever with any respiratory symptom, which can be cough, cold, sore throat, or body aches, so then that such patients need to be tested for COVID. So here it's important to remember not to panic, but it is necessary to get tested. Most of the times it will be a mild illness and it will just pass off like any other cold. But it is more important so that in case somebody tests positive, they are quarantined appropriately and the infection does not spread to other people who are at risk of a more severe infection. So you may be having elderly people at home, or those with chronic diseases like hypertension, diabetes, pregnant women, young babies. So these are some of the populations which are at risk for severe disease. So it's more important to protect them. So it is very important for any patient with a fever, with cough or cold, to get tested for the disease.
So what do we do in case a child tests positive for COVID-19? This definitely is the most panicky and the worst possible scenario right now. But Dr. Madhu, what do we do in case somebody tests for positive?
Yeah. As I told you, first thing is don't panic. So, and the next thing is to get in touch with your doctor. So initially let it be through a video consultation so the patient does not unnecessarily keep wandering outside. And if your doctor, after a video consultation, feels that you need to visit the hospital, then you can go to the hospital. Or if you feel that any of the danger signs which I had explained earlier are present, then you need to visit the hospital immediately. Otherwise, take a video consult. Here, most of the times, it is a mild illness. That is what we call as the influenza-like illness. That is just like a common cold, and that can be managed at home. So it is more important to take all the other precautions like hand washing, using hand rubs, using a face mask, following all the respiratory etiquette, especially when coughing and sneezing, and isolating the child or the patient from the others, especially those who are at higher risk for severe disease. It's important to follow all these precautions more. If your doctor on video consultation feels that you need to visit the hospital, or if you yourself feel that any of those danger symptoms and signs are present in the child, then you can visit the hospital. So even if somebody is positive, please don't panic. It is something which passes off as a mild illness most of the time, especially in children. There have been hardly any cases where it has become very severe. So overall, it is a mild illness in children. It is more important to limit its spread so that we take its proper precaution. So that is why the government is insisting on getting everybody with symptoms to be tested.
Great. So I may also add that we are having a home quarantine package for our children. So any child testing positive, since like doctors already mentioning that they're usually having mild or no symptoms at all. So with the comfort of the home itself, the parents can manage the children. You can always call us or log on to our website to know more about this package. So what we do is we give the kit which has all the necessary things such as the oximeter, the thermometer, N95 masks, gloves, sanitizers, surface disinfectants. And also we'll be giving you some leaflets on how to quarantine at home, how to follow effective disinfection practices, and what are the emergency situations in which you have to connect with the hospital. There will be a daily monitoring chart with which a nurse will be doing a video consultation every day. A doctor will do a video consultation once in 2 days. We will review all your signs and symptoms of the child, see how the progress is going on. A dietitian will also initially consult and help prepare a diet chart and help add on immuno-boosting diets in the food of the child. And I must say that since we've started this package, we've had a few parents who already completed the package as well. And they've been very happy, and they've said that it's far more relaxing for them to manage the child at home rather than leave them in a hospital to manage, especially with mild or no symptoms at all. Dr. Aditi, one parent is asking me here that she's a mother of a 10-month-old baby, and she has got tested for COVID positive 2 days back. Can she continue feeding the baby by expressing the milk, or should she avoid completely feeding the baby by breast milk, and should she get the baby tested for COVID as well?
See, because the baby has been breastfeeding and must have been in contact, I think baby is also at risk of being positive. So even if the symptoms are not there, but I think if contact tracing is being done, the child should also be tested. If the child turns to be negative, child has to be taken care by somebody who is negative. So the other person, either the health, that also should be COVID-free. And in that case, if she decides to express her milk, the milk should be expressed, and the container, which can be a source of spreading the infection, has to be taken care of. And when the mother is giving it to the person who's taking care, they should wash hands, then they should give. But because I think at 9 months, breastfeeding is not that important, we can refrain and give the child a solid-based diet, more like cereals and porridge or a rice kanji or a ragi kanji. The issue is when the child is less than a month or less than 6 months, when they exclusively depend on mother's milk, and then it may be a problem. But here I think she can shift more on a solid-based diet in between, express her milk, take care that the containers are well sterilized before shifting to the baby. And I think the baby should get tested. Dr. Madhu, what is your take?
Yeah, perfect. Asymptomatic contact, especially since it is a baby, better they get tested.
Okay. Dr. Madhu, we have Tejaswin and Nitin who's asking us a question, which is valid for all parents probably. How to make their children wear a mask? Her baby is 1.5 years old and refuses to wear a mask.
Yeah, see, like there are so many different kinds of masks available, and it may not be possible for kids to be wearing masks always. If they are at home, like it is, I think, quite okay not to use the mask unless you have an adult who is developing symptoms recently or till all those issues are sorted out. When they are going out, they need to use masks, all the kids also, as far as possible. And I think the mask has to be comfortable. So many countries, the studies have shown that even using cloth masks or whatever is being sold nowadays is also helpful in limiting the spread of infection. So just choose a soft and comfortable cloth mask. And like it may be difficult for very young kids to use them. And it is more important to follow other precautions like minimizing going out of home and following social distancing and maintaining adequate hygiene with hand washing. So all these are also equally important. You would add like to add anything, Aditi, here?
Yeah, so we have those bandanas, so even a hanky at home, just a cloth strip can be well made into a mask, because a 3-ply mask or N95 may not be comfortable for children, and they would be keep struggling with the mask. So that would be a more problem, keep touching their faces. So in fact, as simple as Tav said, that is as soft as possible, as comfortable as it can be. Those masks should be used for children. So we have in market also soft, fancy and soft and masks for children as well.
Okay, thank you so much. Dr. Madhu, do you want to summarize our talk for today to all the parents who maybe join in a little late?
Yeah, sure. So the basic aim of this session was to just create more awareness among parents of the common childhood infections and the common problems that they have, especially with the focus on common colds, upper respiratory infections, and some of the tummy issues like vomiting, diarrhea, worm infestations, and all that. So as you know, most of the problems in children are mild, and especially when it is infection, most of the times it is a viral infection. So it is important for parents to know, since fever is the commonest presentation of all infections, how to check temperature at home and how to treat the fever at home, which we have summarized, and especially to take at least one consultation with a doctor because we have the ongoing pandemic, and it has to be preferably a video consultation to minimize the risk of getting infections by going to the hospital. And if your doctor feels that you need to go to the hospital, then it is better to go. And you need to also remember the danger signs which I spoke about to recognize whether your child is sick and needs to be taken to the emergency or it can just be managed at home. And especially you need to be aware of the current guidelines where all those with fever, with cough or cold need to be tested for COVID. It's important not to panic, and it is important to continue taking the precautions because this is something which will stay for some time, and we need to get adjusted to the new normal. And it is also important that children may not be able to articulate their stress during this time. It is important to give your child a healthy lifestyle by not only focusing on the physical aspects like a good diet, sleep, and activity, monitoring for illnesses and getting in touch with doctors when necessary, but also to give a good social, emotional, and spiritual atmosphere at this time to tackle them best.
Okay. Dr. Aditi, any closing statements from your end?
It was well concluded by Dr. Madhu. It is the new lifestyle which we have to follow, and in this staying indoors, we have to keep ourselves safe. And Rainbow Children Hospital is always there to help you and guide you, and through our video consults, through your physical visits. Just don't worry, things should be fine.
Okay. Getting a lot of questions on the panel, but can we just take one, maybe last couple of questions? Dr. Madhu, there's a 3-month-old child who's going to be flying with the parents. Any precautions to be taken on the flight?
Yeah, like it depends. Like nowadays, see, like all the usual precautions you need to take, wearing a mask, using hand washing, using hand rubs, social distancing. So this again, like I'm not aware of the kind of flight you're going and where you're traveling to. And what parents have been telling us is many times outside in airports or in the flights, even though you are following all the precautions, there may be others who are not. So yes, like just follow all the usual precautions and have a first aid kit yourself, especially when you're traveling. So which should consist of the common things that we use for children, probably one thermometer, a bottle of paracetamol syrup, some nasal saline drops. And if it is going to be a very long travel, or if your child already, in case anybody is having symptoms, or if you have a high risk population, better to even keep a pulse oximeter with you. And one reliable contact of a doctor or any other medical professional whom you can contact when there is any problem. So anything more, Aditi?
True, sir. If they must have decided for flight because of seeing their situation. So we can't tell them not to go or go. So then you have to take your precautions. Be careful. You save flight.
So thank you so much for all the parents who have joined in. We definitely had a very informative session. Dr. Aditi, Dr. Madhu, thank you for your time. I hope we were able to reply to as many questions as possible. A lot more parents are asking questions. I would like to reiterate that you can definitely book a video consult with us at this time so that you can have your personal questions answered about your child. I've had parents asking about, the child spitting up curd milk, waking up with swollen eyes. I'm sure we'll be able to take it up one by one with the doctors. We are open 24/7 for all emergencies, both the children and obstetric emergencies. We are also, doctors are available full time from morning to evening for the video consults and in house consultations as well. And this particular webinar, we will be making a link of it available, the video on YouTube very soon, so that you may go back to the questions which were answered. You may also share it with your friends, families, other parents who were probably not able to join these sessions, so that it's kind of informative to all. And I would like to again say, stay home, stay safe, and thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Girija.
Thank you, Dr. Aditi. Thank you, Dr. Madhu.
Thank you, Dr. Madhu. Thank you, parents.